Good morning, teacher. I am Frank, and today I will be your guide through
Carlos's blog,
Teacher Effectiveness. Philippine drama indeed has a rich and colorful history. This episode of
Carlos's Blog is about the Philippine theater forms, elements of drama, and the difference between drama and theater.
Episode 1 of
Carlos's Blog
begins as Carlos plunges into many of his first attempts during that summer. One is to write his own blog, and two is his first theater experience with the Ricardo Santa Ana Workshop. In this episode, the aim is for students to understand how drama is depicted in our country and how the colonizers influenced it. The episode also sheds light on tobacco consumption and abuse. Now, the best way to make this lesson interesting is to set the mood of the class. To set the mood, the teacher may divide the class into groups and ask them to write what they know about drama. The teacher may ask the students to use a concept map. The teacher then writes the answers of the students based on the group's report. Remember, it is very important that the teacher leads the students to the definition of drama based on the student's sharing and outputs.
After making sure that the students know and can define what drama is, the teacher may lead the students to the next topic, which is Philippine theater forms, by asking this question.
How is drama related to the events that happen or have happened in real life? The teacher then gathers the students' answers and tells them that these will be assessed after viewing the episode. The class views
Carlos's Blog,
Episode 1.
Remember the time we watched Sinacolo? Everything was fantastic. Roman soldiers with their menacingly painted masks and armors, Barabbas, Pilato.
The actors were all so passionate.
Wow, Lola! You're part of history!
I would say yes.
Contemporary theater!
By early 60s, it was difficult to draw audience to plays. It was realized that the problem was language, that although some Filipinos had the command of the language necessary to write works, English was still not the language of the majority. Thus, audiences were limited to the highly educated and to those devoted to theater. Playwrights and theater groups initially translated Western classics and then adapted it into Philippine context. Later, playwrights soon developed stories written in the vernacular, tackling different issues, concerns, and contexts of the contemporary society.
Moro Moro, which is a commedia, dramatizes the conflict between medieval Christian kingdoms and the Moorish Empire and ends in the triumph of the Christians over the Moors or the Muslims.
Oh, here's another one, the Zarzuela.
Are you aware of the pre-colonial drama? Drama then was community-based and oriented. It was a recreation of events that happened in real life. And it all began in mimetic ritual where the people imitate actions of animals or recount hunting experiences. Later, pre-colonial drama advanced to discussing familiar themes like love, love triangle, parental objections, and others. Learn and be proactive.
And don't smoke.
That's right.
This episode presents Philippine theater forms and how it has been influenced throughout history.
After the video, the teacher may engage the students in a discussion.
In the discussion, the teacher may use this timetable as a guide in presenting Philippine theater forms.
Long before the Spaniards invaded our country, our forefathers have already embraced the concept of theater in their daily lives. Thus, the first form of indigenous drama in the pre-colonial period are the rituals. Different rituals mark the progress of people's life using symbolic movements, song, dance, speech, allegory, and objects to invoke, appease, and honor the spirits. Rituals were vital points in community then, since they were believed to be the source of their supernatural power, bountiful harvest, and protection against their foe. The next form of indigenous drama under the pre-colonial period is verbal jousts or games. Examples of these are Bayok of the Maranao tribe, Dalot from Ilocos, Panyo Palduran, an Ilonggo game, Desposorio, and the most common example, Duplo and Karagatan. Another form of indigenous drama are the songs and dances. Some of the songs involved not only words and music, but verbal exchange and mimetic action. Many dances dramatize the gestures and movements of war. Some dances are directly imitative of occupational activities, movements of animals, and history of the community. Spaniards did not recognize the indigenous forms as drama, since they are accustomed of seeing drama with costume, stage, and was performed from a prepared text. Spanish friars branded these rituals as superstitious and ignorant. When the Spaniards set foot in our country, other forms of drama were introduced. The comedia or moro-moro. Folk authors weave stories of kings and queens, prince and princess, sultan, generals, and knights, with themes of love, courtship, fighting in tournaments, foreign lands, and braving dangers in the forest, being helped by magic and miracles to bring their ventures to happy endings. Characters affect the flow of the story. The leading prince usually initiates action and is the protagonist, while the other princes and princesses provide the subplot. The clown played a major role, not only as the comic relief, but also as the social commentator. Another form of theater influenced by the Spaniards are religious plays. These were not considered theater, for they only required minimal amount of theatrical expression. The growth of Teatro Español was always associated with religious feasts or about the lives of the saints. Lastly, we have the zarzuela. As a dramatic form, the zarzuela is not indigenous to the Philippines. Two principal influences that shaped the Filipino zarzuela are the Filipino sainetes and the Spanish zarzuela. The rapid spread of zarzuela all over the country may be attributed to a complex of circumstances. Number one, with the disappearance of repressive censorship under Spain, which inhibited any form of realism in literature. With the search for Filipino identity in the periods of reform and revolution. And finally, with the popularization of a more scientific educational system under America. Filipinos were ready for a kind of theater that would be more truthful in its depiction of Philippine realities. Number two, American censorship encouraged the creation and presentation of literary works like the zarzuela, which did not assail the American occupation the way seditious dramas did, but instead contented itself with portrayal of local customs. And number three, the zarzuela began to enjoy the financial support of the feudal aristocracy. Now for a breather, the teacher may ask this question to serve as an introduction to the American period. During the American period, this form of theater thrived into the vernacular even before the zarzuela. These are the seditious plays. This form of drama was predominantly romantic and or tragic and or comedic. Themes that one can associate with soap operas and heavy drama. Their purpose was to convey the ideas of nation and independence, and to persuade the audience into action and commitment. Political plays of 1902 to 1906 used native language not only to reach the audience, but also to protect the message from the Americans who were the object of its barbs. Vaudeville is an indigenized form of vaudeville, which had been introduced in the Philippines around the turn of the 20th century. One trivia. Did you know that the late comedy king Dolphy and Nora Honor started their show business careers performing in vaudeville? After the Japanese occupation and the war, lights of vaudeville stage were dimmed, and soon the academic-based theater began, the plays in English. And finally, for the last period in our timeline, we have the contemporary drama, also known as the return to the vernacular context. Since the four major era of theater in the Philippines, other forms of theater have flourished and evolved over the years. Protest theater. Folklore. Musical plays. Curriculum plays. Informant. Multimedia productions. After this activity of recalling facts, the teacher may deepen the student's comprehension by asking these critical questions. How did the colonizers affect the growth of Philippine drama? What are the themes or messages reflected in Philippine drama during each period? The teacher may also conduct this activity to further enhance the students' learning. Divide the students into groups according to pre-colonial, Spanish, American, and contemporary. Ask the groups to write a drama on the highlights of the period assigned to them and perform it in class. Another suggested activity could be a role-playing wherein the class is divided into groups and are tasked to pretend like a playwright. Now, each group has to choose a current social issue that they would like to write for the role-play. The teacher can also allow the students to incorporate the critical issue, which is tobacco consumption and abuse, with their chosen social issue. This activity develops a sense of awareness in the social and critical issues in the present times. This activity can also develop skills and creativity in writing a script, critical thinking and open-mindedness in discussing and analyzing the social and critical issues. To synthesize the lesson, the teacher may pose the question, how is drama related to the events that happen or have happened in real life? The teacher may end the lesson with a conclusion that drama is simply a recreation or representation of events that happen or have happened in real life. Thank you for joining me. This has been your Teacher Effectiveness co-teacher, Frank. At your service, and see you again next time.